Hello and welcome to Lit Nama. I'm your host Lakshmi Krishnan. Of course, all of us are still struggling and coming to terms with this quote-unquote new normal, a phrase that I've grown to hate in this lockdown. But I think one of the things that is keeping us sane is just scrolling through social media, learning how to make new recipes, checking up on our friends and their lives online, and all of us are just connected because of the internet. But just as we mindlessly scroll on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or any other platform, there is an entire different side to social media that has also been active, struggling, fighting for people's rights. Not just people's rights, but also for the environment's rights, for you and me and for where we live and for the Mother Earth. And today we have on our episode someone who is called to be the social media manager of Mother Earth. This particular guest spends a lot of time using her reels, using her Instagram posts and captions and stories to create a lot of awareness about what is happening in the world. The last time I checked up on her, she was actively making reels about draft EIA, against draft EIA, telling people what exactly is happening, giving them insights through research and statistics. And basically, one of our videos amounted up to 40,000 views. That too, all of this power-packed in 15 seconds. This makes me curious. And to answer all of my curiosities and to understand how could you and I use social media as not just a place to exist, but where we can create our own universes, where we subvert the norms, and where we start a new revolution right from our homes. So please join me right after this short break as I welcome someone who's fondly known on the internet as Radx Bone, the story of which we will uncover in the episode. Please welcome Namrata Menon.
How many times have you motivated yourself to improve your sleep or lose weight or be more productive? How many times have you failed? Hi, my name is Ashton Doctor. Tune into my show, The Habit Coach Podcast, where we focus on creating small, tiny habits to improve your life instead of those big, impossible tasks. So make listening to me a habit every Monday, Wednesday and Friday on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com or on your favorite podcasting app.
Hello, Namrata. Welcome to Lit Nama. It's a pleasure having you on the podcast, finally.
Yeah, even I'm glad. Thank you so much for having me, you know.
And you know, one of the best things of like us speaking is because we've been a part of things so randomly in life.
I know. Yeah.
You are a podcaster too.
Yes, I did have a podcast.
And so you know the drill. So I don't have to explain.
Yeah, definitely.
And it's so interesting because generally, you know, I have to explain to people how a structure or a flow of a conversation works with you. That's easy. And we've been like, it's something so weird because we've known each other but not known each other for so long in our lives that it just feels like I'm speaking to an old friend.
That is pretty true. Like, yeah, I mean, we have like met like very like few times, not as much, but right. Then we have like interacted through and through, and like we know we have that vibe just going on nonetheless.
Right. So my first no-brainer question to you is going to be like, so Radx Bone, how did that come about?
Oh, man.
I can never call you Namrata in my life, I swear.
I know, that's what a lot of people tell me too, you know. But, I mean, I don't want to go like very, like literal into it, but I was while growing up, like because of just being like the rebel in the house, I was constantly called like, you're such a radical, oh my God, you're such a radical person and all that. So I was like, okay, I'm just being assertive. And why is assertive? Is being assertive what is radical? So I was like, fine with being called so, right? But then, and then that got stuck with me as well. And even the word rad was so like, you know, doing like the rounds on social media when I was making like this account name, and I was like, okay, let's just name it like Radical to the Bones or Rad to the Bones and, you know, things like that. But I completely agree that I am to my core pretty like, you know, fabulous. That's what I used to tell myself. And I was like, yeah, that's how it got stuck, you know. But it's also something that I aspire to, because yeah. I understand that I cannot be that person like all the time, right? But it's something I always try to look up to and be like, okay, I can do this. I can be radical because radical is my assertiveness.
Oh my God. That's so cool because the side effect of your username has been the fact that the entire universe thinks your name is Radhika.
Oh yeah. So many people have asked me randomly, like, I thought your name was Radhika. I was like, no, it's Namrata. That is also something they will not register. So I was like, "Haan, bhai, Radix honi chalega, use that."
So apart from the name, a lot of people on the internet also know you for the amazing reels you make.
Uh-huh.
And I know the reels are like the most recent addition to all the work that you've been doing over the years on social media. So how did this entire thing start? Because I know you as someone who's very vocal online about all the kinds of things that are happening in the world. And like your research is so thorough and so on point with everything, like be it talking about the environment, be it talking about the anti-CAA protest, be it about menstruation, everything. How do you go about it and where did you, like, how did this idea of doing this start?
For me, the research part of it is like, I like reading a lot, right? And it's not that I can completely write that well, but the thing is, I just have to know something about, say, a topic. If I come across something and I have to know at least a little bit basic about it, right? And when I go to know the something about it, what happens is I automatically find the whole thing interesting. So then I sit down and then I have like a book around me and then I keep noting down points about it. And then I realized like if I have so much information, I need to share it because like without sharing it, I feel it's completely useless. And that is something that I have, you know, tried to, I want to call it like, say, Reels is a very bite-sized way to put across information. And even if Reels is like a very recent addition, like for me as a person also in person, if I'm talking to people, I'm constantly like talking and, you know what, this happened and then this is related to that. And what I do is I do like a, I always like try to zoom out from the picture, right? So if there's a link that comes across and there are a few keywords that are in the link or an article or a book or anything, like anything bite-sized, what I do is try to use those keywords to find other information on it. Because I think that everything somehow is connected to something else, you know, and there has to be some link between two different things. So maybe me trying to find that link is how I try to get more information to myself. And that is what makes me want to... So with Reels, what happened was I saw a lot of, say, American creators or, say, creators from the West who were trying to give a lot of information in Reels, right? And they were trying to be, like, very direct about the information. But then what I realized is that, for the Indian audience, what I wanted to do is I wanted to grab their attention. And because of so much of information there's so much information overload, I didn't want it to be just something you swipe across, like swipe up, like, you know, like I didn't want something ki ha dekha, okay, this is too much overload, I'm gonna just swipe up. So then I thought ki, okay, the only way that the Reels or even TikTok had like a very big base was everything was funny at some point. Even creative things, yes, of course, but there was an element of fun or funny or something involved in it at all. And what I really, really like doing is I really like to mock people in power because, I want to dismantle that idea that they are, you know, like they cannot be questioned or they cannot be, they cannot be like as human as we are. Like, and it's so easy. Like, I realized it's so easy for people to, make fun of the powerless. So I wanted to just change the narrative and be like, I want to make fun of people who are like at the seat, you know, with the money and things like that. And most of my reels are like happen to be like that. And the thing is, some people, they definitely find that relatable as well, you know. Yes, the information is getting across, but at the same time that, you know, massive relatability is there because I am trying to normalize that. You know, you can mock the power because, people directly ask me, like, even you thought that, you know, it's quite difficult to constantly, keep doing these things because at some point people are scared to do this, right? People are scared to question people in power. So I'm just like, even after that, I try to do very safe. Like, I try to play very safe, you know, Like all my reels before they go on upload, I send it to my sister, I send it to one of two of my friends, and be like, okay, this is not too offensive, right? I don't want to be too offensive. And then they're like, oh no, it's fine, just go ahead with it. High time people start doing this, and you know, others should also do this kind of a thing.
It's so interesting. I'm just so amused at how your brain just works, right? Because I remember watching a reel which mounted up to like 40,000 views. Mm-hmm. And it's so simple, like it's so lucidly put. I mean, it's not simplistic. It does not water down an issue. But it just tells you that this is a starting point, which is very important. Like how your sister and how your friends rightly say that it's high time people need to do this. We live like at the equal part in time. We live in a time where shadow banning is completely normal, where getting your Twitter accounts or your Instagram account suspended for saying something, for even saying men are trash, you get like a Facebook, like a strike for that.
Exactly.
And we live in times where, you know, go make me a sandwich is equally a valid statement. How do you even figure out, because you know, like when you were speaking, I realized there are too many things happening in the world at once, especially in 2020. But I remember the golden times of 2018, 2017, where most of us were gaining our political consciousness. We were just figuring out that, hey, listen, you know what? I'm not going to sit here and take whatever you throw at me.
Exactly.
And one of the things that happened at that time was like Facebook debate, right? We lost so many friends in the process. But I remember being someone who was this angsty person who used to fight every Facebook debate with the same rigor of like an academic research, you know?
Yeah.
And I used to give them statistics. I used to give them all of these and they used to just end up saying, oh, you're fat, you shut up.
Yeah, I mean, if it's not what they want us to say, it's like, oh my God. Like, they have those cuss words ready. And I'm like, okay, this was a discussion 2 minutes ago. Now it's just, like, it's useless.
And then you sit there and you're wondering, like, why do I even waste my time and energy? Mm-hmm. And one side effect of that has been on my life is the fact that, I have very, like, reduced patience for crap, like, I will not tolerate you if you're my friend. If you're going to say something that stands against human values, then I'm not going to sit there and listen to you or associate with you. I've had that sort of a growth, I would like to call it. But at the same time, it has made me very tired about using social media. You know, like going on Twitter feels like an actual task that I need to add to my to-do list. Because every single tweet, you'll see such a variety of opinions today that sometimes it gets so chaotic that what do you believe? Who do you believe? And, you know, like, do we put people on a pedestal too soon?
Oh, yeah.
And all of those questions sort of trouble me so much because one of the things that I think you have also spoken about very openly is the fact that, you know, politics is personal, but also, like, so is privilege. Mm-hmm. So what might be someone's problem for me might be like a utopian dream. Mm-hmm. How do you navigate all of this chaos? How is it like in your head?
Yeah, so like, you know, from the way you began, when there was, say, shadow ban has begun, right? Like whether it's accounts, posts and everything of that sort. And I remember after that, reel that went across really well. It was like from the point of view of people, Mother Earth, God, Satan, all of them kind of against draft EI 2020, right? Like that was the funny aspect of it. And I was like, okay, I need to bring up something like that, you know, the perspective of how annoyed we are and how frustrated we are with this whole draft EI bill. And the thing is, okay, I did a reel and I thought, okay, this is the next viral thing that's going to happen, okay? And okay, and then I realized that, okay, either it was too bad or I am shadow banned because the views did not even cross like 500, 600. And I was like, okay. But then I told myself, okay, it's not that bad. I was pretending to be like Mother Earth to be super angry with this particular bill. And that too in the middle of a pandemic. Like that was the gist of the drill. And then like say 2 to 3 days later when I was like super upset about this reel not working out at all, I get like one comment on that reel saying that, hey, now so it looks like that you are Mother Earth's social media manager. And trust me, I felt so wholesome with that comment. I was like, okay, fine. I don't mind being Mother Earth's social media manager. That's a cool thing to, like, a cool job to have. I don't mind. And the thing is that then none of that mattered, you know, this didn't crack up like it did in the previous reel. But I got that one comment and I was like, oh, I'm fine with this. At least this I got, you know. So you're right. Like, the fatigue is quite high when it comes to these, you know, state machinery, which is stopping us from speaking, you know, we never thought that we'll come out of, like, we'll go on Instagram, it'll be just our usual thing. But then it's like such a web where people are, it feels like you're in a simulation and you are nowhere in control of it, right? So, yeah. Like, I get that, but then these small tiny things is what gets me through. So, and I mean, there are good days, there are bad days, and I got so used to that shadow ban and that whole process of it. I just like take like a week off of social media when that happens. Because usually they say that shadow ban gets over within the 14 days or like 10 days. These are like the, you know, fleeting numbers that you'll hear online in different blogs. So then that is when I get like that 1 week. When I realize I'm shadow ban, I take that break at that moment, you know. So it's like, I have to take the break as well, right? Because the fatigue does happen. And for me, like, I earlier used to subscribe to that hustle culture baby bullshit. But then very soon I realized that, you know, resting is part of productivity as well. And I mean, that has been the biggest thing I have taught myself on my own, I would say. Of course, with the help of the internet resources and therapy and friends, and, you know, we discussed amongst ourselves that, no, you have, like, without rest, what are you going to achieve? Or who are you going to achieve it for? Or what are you, you know, going to succeed in if you don't rest it out? You know, you have to be in a good mood when you get something that you want to get. So it was like that only. So whenever, say, for example, with a draft AI bill, whenever they gave that, okay, we'll postpone the dates. So in the beginning, I was so exhausted because we were worried, right? Like, the date is nearby. Everything has to go out by this time, this hour. Everything was managed that way with, you know, different groups that we were parts of. And I was like, you know, by the end of the time, when they postpone the dates, we think that, oh, we're supposed to be happy about it, but nothing about this seems happy, you know, because they're churning us out. They're churning us out in the middle of a pandemic. They're churning us out for a useless notification. This notification should not be here in the first place, you know. That's when I realized that, say, my reels are about postponing the dates. And you know what? My reels are supposed to be about discarding the entire draft AI 2020. So then I made an entire video about how, you know what, forget postponing. At any point that this comes out, we don't want that law. We don't want it to become a notification. And that's when I realized that more than it being like, say, so time driven, of course, there are dates and deadlines you have to meet, but more than it being so, you know, constant 24/7 thing, I need to incorporate that resting period as well in between all of this, you know.
And I'm also thinking about this entire idea of rest also, and how we are constantly made to feel that resting is not worth it. As an activist, like, I remember when the anti-CA protests were happening, a lot of social media updates were like telling people to go replace, you know, protesters, like relieve them for a while from Gateway when the first one happened, and go there and, you know, stay there with them, or send food, send beverages, or whatever. The idea of, I somewhere feel like this entire hustle culture, like, feeling is not a part of it. Like, it's very, very statistically out there that hustle culture is sort of a byproduct of capitalism. But, you know, sometimes I feel like social media complicates the idea of rest so much. Because you're supposed to be always online. You're supposed to be always accessible. You're made to feel that, you know, if, especially as a content creator, right? I mean, this is a question that's like sort of a two-edged sword, that when you're an activist as well as a content creator, how do you, I mean, it's great that you get that time to rest when the shadow ban comes around. So many people today are very actively trying to get into this space, trying to become people who are aware and who are vocal, but how did it work for you in the beginning when you were just building up and figuring out how would you speak about something? Or I remember when Sevare was happening, I saw a lot of videos from your end. I saw a lot of posts, a lot of informative stories, constant research happening. How do you keep up with all of that? Because how do you keep up with activism and research and social media at the same time?
So, see, initially, like I said, like, you know, the whole 2017-2018 era, there was that awareness brewing inside all of us that, hey, what's happening? And the thing is, I wouldn't say that that happened only because few certain things happened around us, but I would say that from like a whole, kya bolte, like 17, 18, 19 ka perspective, say we came into that, hey, 21, 22, 23, where we were like, okay, we are taking life decisions, but life decisions are so difficult to take. What's causing this difficulty? Oh, so many systemic issues are causing these difficulties. You know, so when a lot of decision-making process took place in my life, that's when I realized that, wait, there are a lot of issues here that's not letting me do the way I want to do things. So that's when we started addressing these things, right? And yes, I, of course, was like a content creator on social media, and I had absolutely no, you know, I wouldn't say it was not political. My posts were political, but they were not activism driven at all. And even now I would say I try to keep that balance because my work is also on social media and like this is also something I do. So when that shadow ban happens, like I would completely say that like for the past 1 year, what work I used to get from social media, it's completely nil right now because of how politically active I have become on social media. So now my work has completely been, say, word of mouth, or, you know, from other means that I'm trying to build right now, because I've realized that it's all, after all, a bubble, right? Like the content creation is like a bubble. And yeah, if tomorrow everything just shuts down, where am I going to find my clients, or how am I going to further move on? So I realized that I need to create an offline base as well. And that's something I realized I'll work on. And now what happened was, say a year ago, say the beginning of 2019, that's when I realized that, you know, I heard a song, like I was really into rap music, and I came across Swadesi's song, which was yes, and it was exactly, it is such a strong song, right? And when I heard that, okay, and I knew RA movement was going on, but like this, when I saw that culmination of Swadesi and the movement, I was like so happy, and I was like, okay, yeah, you can totally do art and make a point. And the thing is, not that I didn't know that that's possible. The thing is, I used to think everyone's scared to voice their opinion. So definitely nobody's going to voice their opinion. Maybe even I should not. And some sort of strength and like push I got from that rap song. And I was like, okay, maybe I need to like know what's going behind the movement and things like that. And of course, so it's when you come across people from the movement, it's all like a group coming together, right? You would not see, and for specifically for RA, it was such a people's movement. You would have seen any person from any party coming and being like, okay, you know what? I don't know which party I'm from, and I don't care right now, because I have lived my life in RA. I have come here with my grandfather. I have played here. I have done this, I have done that. RA is like that personal thing for me. This is something I don't agree with this current government's approach. So then what happened is they all would come in and we would pitch in, right? So it started with, hey, can you, because I was an editor and content creator, my contribution was, okay, content create karo, kaise bhi karna hai to. And it was, at first it was like, do in your own individual capacity. If you're creating videos, do that. If you're making posts for this, that's also fine. Like it was all give and take, and it was all going on well. And then it started with video editing, then it started with video recording. And then I jumped into, okay, you know what? Protests are happening because nobody's listening to us. Why don't you join? And I was like, oh my God, definitely I'm joining. Because that's when I realized that, you know what? There is a point where a due process, like say giving those emails, giving those letters, asking public pressure, dalke jo bhi karna hai na, sab kar liya tha. But we were still met with such harsh responses, you know. So that is when everyone in the moment was like, okay, let's get down on the road. And I was completely new to that because, see, there is a huge difference when it comes to, say, sitting, being a social media influencer who's trying to raise awareness about something, and someone who's on the ground reality,
right,
who,
yeah,
strategizes everything from the beginning to end. And for social media activists and influencers, how the thing is, ki jo hua, I have to tell my followers. But that's not the case with other people. A lot of people strategize. See, they see that what's going to help the movement, then what's going to help them or their audience first, you know? Like, even if there's an information that's supposed to be, I mean, you tell me, if I have some critical information that will help me in a case, I should not be sharing it to the world, right? Like, these are the things that I learned when I was on ground, that this is not just a social media movement that we have to keep telling people to join, or this is not just a social media movement that we have to tell everything to everyone. They have to come on ground and learn the reality, you know. And I think that was the, even there were taglines, you know, ki kabhi to aare karke, you know, ki some kabhi to you come to aare type. So, and these are the things that I've learned. And I would say that only, I remember the main thing, and the only thing I used to do basically for RM's movement was just put on stories that, hey, protest is happening, come. And I was like, okay, fine. And then I started getting 2-3 people coming and telling me that, hey, you know what? I came here because I saw your stories. And that's the moment I realized, hey, I'm not going to stop this anymore. Because I got people to get out of their bed on a Sunday to come and stand. And I'm telling you, nobody regretted it, because RA is beautiful in that way, right? You are not going to regret coming there on a Sunday. And that's the very reason we are going to save it, right? The personal reason that, dude, RA is too beautiful because I was there in my childhood, or RA is beautiful right now because it's so beautiful, or RA is going to be something I want my future generation to know. So even the person from an XYZ political party says that I'm going to come here because ये मेरे पर्सनल बात पे आ गए ये लोग कि नहीं आरे को तो हाथ नहीं लगाने का, यू नो. सो दैट आई रियलाइज्ड कि हम लोग बोलते बहुत इजीली है कि पॉलिटिकल एंड पर्सनल इज द सेम थिंग, बट आई सॉ इट कम इनटू फ्रुएशन इन दिस मूवमेंट, राइट? बिकॉज एवरी पार्टी और एवरी पॉलिटिकल पर्सन फ्रॉम एनी एक्सवाइजी पार्टी वॉज देयर, और पीपल्स मूवमेंट वर देयर, और से एनीबडी हु वाज लाइक, वी आर एपॉलिटिकल, वी डोंट नो व्हाट्स हैपनिंग, बट यू नो व्हाट, वी आर गोना सेव आरे. और एवरीवनस लाइक, yeah, I mean, climate change scares the shit out of us. Or people came there with like, people who are parents with children, they were like, oh, we want them to know what RA was because we grew up playing here. So these are the things that made me realize that this is a bit more than what I was thinking it is. And I don't mind playing this tiny part in it, you know, that if I can do something small, I'm going to do it. And that's how it started.
I'm just so spellbound because when you were talking about it, I could actually see all of it in front of my eyes all over again. I actually hear Valley Revolt playing in the background because I remember watching your stories and like seeing information about Draft EIA. And I remember sending an email because your story reminded me that if you haven't sent an email, please do send it. So I made sure I sent it from like all the email accounts I've ever created, including my embarrassing childhood email ID. and so I completely understand when you're saying this. And my next question also was going to be about the idea of being apolitical and the sort of complacency that comes on social media, right? Mm-hmm. As much as, you know, like Instagram is designed for you to look at things, it also becomes easy to look away or for the algorithm to screw you over.
Right. Absolutely.
So, like, it depends upon how much do you interact with someone. And then maybe it becomes very important for social media activists to create interactive content. But at the same time, today you will see a complete rise of misogynistic pages or certain pages that do not actually believe in any political ideology. They don't either believe in the right, left or center. They only believe in ridiculing people, in making sure that we make strangers' lives hell. And that's difficult as a creator to sort of, you either deal with it or you filter it out. There is only like so much you can do about it. How do you generally, and especially I know that since you have been on ground, you might have also run into a lot of these social media people who come there just for coverage or just for, you know, putting up an Instagram story saying I was here.
Yeah, that also happens, definitely. So what my thing was like that only, it's not just people who ridicule, but people who are completely ignorant and have nothing to say about it. Even that is a problem. See, because it's simple, right? Like if the world is burning, you cannot go around eating cake and be like, hey, everything's fine. You just cannot be that person anymore. Especially at this era where very well the same thing can affect you. Okay? And then when you want people to stand up with you because a collective voice is only going to get you justice, you expect that collective voice to come and it's for you. But if you don't extend that to someone else, it's what are you then? Like, why are you expecting someone else to do the same for you, right? So, and it's like, it's not just that, right? And even the, what do we say? Like the apolitical spectrum, I would say, for example, this is something that I always wanted to, you know, tune in with, say, all these individual actions that a person is supposed to take to, you know, stop climate change, okay? Like you'll see multiple articles on that fact, or I won't even say fact, on that, you know, idea that individuals have the ability to change, you know, or stop climate change. And I'm like, I'll tell you what, we are anyway, India is anyway going into the direction of being a climate change denier. So on top of that, if you put that whole onus on individuals, trust me, we're not going to go nowhere, you know. Like, I agree that, yes, you can do as much as you want individually and, you know, go around being like a low-waste lifestyle. And that's something even I promote. Like, I would always be like, okay, single-use plastic is something you have to let go of. I agree. But then, you know, the whole movement gets clouded by these paid campaigns. You know, even when in the era of 2000, right, like there were climate change activists who started speaking about, you know, the emissions, the footprint, and like how oil rig industry is just ruining it for all of us. But, you know, like oil, because the money that oil has, oil paid retired scientists to pretend to say that, you know what, climate change will only happen, climate change will be only in control when individuals change their habit, you know? And what they did was they tried to tell people that it's not the companies that are at fault. Companies are creating and manufacturing things for you, but you are the one buying it. So you are the problem here. They said, oh, you're the problem here. And trust me, no. An individual person who needs a car to go like kilometers away for his job is not the problem here. The problem is that you keep digging the rig and you do it with no regulations followed. So, and then these oil spills happen. Like recently we had like the Malaysian beach oil spill, right? And it was so devastating to see like a blue colored water, sea and ocean turning so black in the middle of it, you know? And then what happens is this process, the thing is called greenwashing, where you blame it on the individuals, you blame it on the tiniest of habits and things like that. Like even for that matter, straws were not at all a problem as much, like of course they are, but the amount of marketing that went into straws being the cause for climate change was just waste, because there are a lot of other things that are drained in the ocean. What about that? You know?
Right.
The greenwashing aspect here is you just make the people feel happy for doing the most minuscule, minutest change, and they're not going to question anyone else because they're like, oh, we did our part, right? Now what are we going to do? You know, that kind of a situation. So it converts into, and that's very well happening in India as well, okay, where they'll tell you that, oh, don't take this plastic bag, you know, or don't, like the whole, I agree that you had to be strict somewhere, but tell me, how are you going to charge, say, 5,000 to 8,000 bucks for not, for having plastic by mistake? And the idea of discarding plastic, like, if you're actually concerned about plastic, the first thing you would tell someone is don't discard it. Find a multiple purpose use for it somewhere.
So it's so interesting that, I'm sorry I'm cutting you, but like our mothers always have saved plastic bags. I mean, I'm 100% sure that in my house somewhere, there is a plastic bag that's as old as I am. And you know what, like we've always been very resourceful, but we've been told increasingly that this is something that is wrong. Or this is something that is something that you should not do. And that has sort of created the problem, right? I mean, you're so correct, because I remember this entire debate that we had at our housing society, where we were finally asked to segregate wet and dry waste.
Mm-hmm.
And they had fixed days about when would the wet waste be collected, when would the dry waste be collected. Mm-hmm. But we heard from the Safai Wallas that the truck that comes to collect them is the same. Because on the municipal level, nobody is monitoring waste like or creating secret channels to make sure that discarded as dry and wet and not put in the same goddamn truck.
Yeah.
And like, of course, the society tried to figure out if they could create like a compost pit and all of those things. Mm-hmm. But the fact that your government or your local body is choosing to do nothing about it, it took them a lot of time to finally come around and start sending separate vehicles to collect both the waste. Now, nobody has followed that vehicle and like checked where it goes. I hope they do it someday, but you're so right that greenwashing is so rampant.
Yeah, and the thing is, like you said, right, like the local body is not taking the responsibility of it. It'll be shocking to know, and it is shocking that actually what the state machinery is doing is that they are giving more and more pro-business laws and notification, which allows these businesses who are doing like massive pollution, like say on a very big national and say large scale levels, they're allowing it to create the waste. Or earlier which regulations were there, they're diluting all these regulations, whether it is the producer's responsibility notification or whether it's the e-waste bill that has come out. Like these are the things very introduce karte, nobody comes to know about it, then it gets passed and suddenly there'll be a different way in which we have to deal with it, where we are like, oh, the individual is responsible for it, and the individual is like, I should not buy anything, like I should not buy things for my use or what. Like the individual is in a dilemma all the time, and that's the thing, it blames you, it doesn't blame the person who's actually responsible, the person who's creating the pollution. Because if you're functioning, a circular economy can happen as well. Only if you follow the regulations you followed can be done well. And the thing is, yes, the regulations are in the best right now, but we will hope for it to get better, na? Like with increase in climate change, we'll be like, ha, better laws banao, better ye banao, better karo, strictness karo. And the thing is, the dilution is happening, And when you ask the government or the local body about it, I'm telling you, the reply you'll get is, oh, we did not plantation drive. And that is the second form of greenwashing I want to talk about. I'm not even kidding. That plantation drive is so absurd. Because I'll tell you what, koi bhi crore koti ke saplings tum laga do, jitne saplings lagane laga do, bade bade trees ko nahi replace karne wala na. The big, large, chunk of a banyan tree has an ecosystem around it. It is giving life to birds. It's giving nests. It's giving worms. It's giving small insects, reptiles. It's giving water. Like the branches are so full of water. Groundwater gets saved because of it. You tell me, you want to cut trees in RA and then say, I put so many saplings in Mumbai, which are not at all even... what do we say? Like the survival rates are so low.
Statistically, you concretize the entire city.
Exactly. Like it was 81 at some point. Then you do another study, it was 69. Then you do another study, it was 51. And I was like, what are you maintaining? Like if you see like these, there are a lot of studies which say that a sapling ko tree banne ke liye na 50,000 rupees lagta hai for its actual maintenance. And that money is like a culmination of the amount of water it requires, the amount of solar energy it requires, and things like that, right? Are you telling me that the crore saplings you have planted, ek sapling clay you are going to give 50,000, are you actually doing that? There are two...
I'm going to give like 50 seconds to have a second look at the sapling and check if it is okay.
Exactly. That also we won't do.
I remember reading when the entire metro situation was also happening, the stretch of metro from like Nariman Point to CST, the road that connects it, there's a underground metro coming in place. Mm-hmm. And the bridge, the makeshift bridge they've built on it, there are like these blue, what do you call them? I don't even know the word. Basically, they're like metro ads saying we planted XYZ amount of sapling. When we cut down something to create this metro. And if you sit in a BEST bus and you go over that bridge, you could actually feel the trembles on your seat.
Yeah.
Like, you'll feel the bridge underneath you. Like, it might just give up if two BRT buses cross at the same time. And yeah. I've been scared for my life every time I pass that road. Yeah. How are you going to, like, I feel like human life has become so indispensable at this point for just individual efforts. But on the larger scale, we don't even count. We don't even matter. We're just like another statistic waiting.
I mean, even with the metro planning, right? Like, so many people have raised so many concerns of all the metro lines that were made. Now you go to see, okay, metro was, the Ghatkopar Versova line, agreed, absolutely useful. But you see, monorail, how useless it is right now. Nobody uses it. It is like empty and scary.
Like, I'm sure someone else also believes like the monorail has no point.
Exactly. It's, I love you. It's such a short line. It's just there for the sake of it. Nobody uses it. And the thing is that planning and the concerns raised over it are never taken, were never taken into consideration. And the same thing is happening with the current metros as well. There is, like, if anyone, like, listening to this podcast would have to, like, check out Hussain Indorwala's work and Shweta Berg's work. They're both, like, architects who have tried to really work their ass out into explaining what could be better urban planning for, you know, our city. Because Shweta Berg has, like, you know, she has really done good research on the catchment areas of Mumbai, where if these catchment areas lose their green cover, how much more flooding will we see in Mumbai in the next few years? And the thing is, RA is one of the places where that, you know, Metro Carshed 3 is happening, is one of the catchment areas that she had done a research on. Imagine researching on it and then one day realizing that they are building the Carshed there, you know? And the fact that how it's going to affect the city. Because RA is a good buffer area that actually absorbs a lot of floods and water. Because otherwise, you see, our airports will get flooded very easily. And of course, whatever, Kurla Sai and Matunga that gets flooded like anything. Every single rainy season, people lose their houses, whatnot.
And it just, in the larger scheme of things, sometimes I just sit here and wonder, like, what's the point of imagining, like I remember, like, my father also migrated to Mumbai in the 90s, and he moved here because he wanted better opportunities for himself and his family. Would I want to move out just to give some better life to my family? Maybe.
Exactly. Because
soon all your, like, tier one cities are going to be underwater. We won't have any resource to go on, and what would you do then? Where would you take all of your individual efforts and your cloth bags that they forced you to buy in all these stores? Where are you going to take all those tote bags when nothing will exist to actually put them in?
Exactly.
I think on that learning thought, we should go in for a short break and then come back and discuss more about this.
Yeah, definitely.
Perfect.
Welcome, everybody, to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Like to thank our sponsors this week, Intel. It's been a great week on the network this week. If you haven't been paying attention, please do listen to some of the shows. We had Chetan Bhagat. This was the first returning guest on Cyrus Says. Do check that out. Great, great, great episode. We had Palak Zatakia on Advertising is Dead. Really interesting conversation was had with Varun. We had another crossover on the Habit Coach. Zarina Poonawalla showed up over there to have a discussion with Ashton about anxiety and pressure. Begin the Journey with Ashish Vidyarthi continues to kill it. Please definitely do check it out. An old friend, Vijay Koshi, was on Storytellers and Storysellers. Do check that out as well. And I'd like to mention one thing. If you're a Tamil speaker, you should definitely check out our podcast, Kadai Podcast, Punyan Selvan. Kavita Jeeva has done a fantastic job to finish up her first story. It is the last episode, which just came out last Monday. Do check it out if you speak Tamil. It is an incredible achievement. Please do check that out. And with that, let's get you onto your show.
Welcome back after that really short break. I know that we sort of drifted off thinking about our tote bags. But you know, my brain just has this one more constant wonderment and like this question at the same time. I feel so proud when I look at Gen Z, right? Because if I had that kind of a nuanced political opinion, right or wrong, at 16, mm-hmm. where would I be right now? I have no clue. Because I remember when I was 16, I was still simping on, like, I know simping is not the right word. This is something that a Gen Z has done to me. But I was still crushing on like an Enrique Iglesias. Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's so amazing because most of our social media today is all the kind of content that you see, a majority of it comes from the Gen Z. And, you know, like if I were to take like one small example, it's about how the queer movement in India mm-hmm. is now actually questioning its roots. Yeah. Where you see all cis men generally leading the movement, and now the actual youth is questioning them, saying, hey, you do not represent everything that we stand for. And there's a huge political argument, divide, and all of this going on. This is happening in almost every single sector right now. But don't you also think like they're one of the most resourceful people when it comes to education or when it comes to actually educating someone about an issue? Because it's so like thrifty with everything, like how you use social media or how you create a narrative online. So when, you know, like, I just wanted to also know like your experience with the kind of co-curators, creators that we have on Instagram who are also social media activists. And I know there's a huge thriving network of people who generally look at each other when issues are out and are in solidarity. What kind of a solidarity have you experienced on social media? How has it worked for you?
I mean, to begin with, I would say that, you know, with every generation, I am really glad that, you know, that like that basic understanding of, you know, hey, we a lot of, you know, the whole, okay, you can talk whatever you want to talk about and no shame here, you know, no judgments in this room. That kind of kept increasing in every generation. Like we saw like our previous generation boomers who used to shame anything and everything, right? And then we saw millennials kind of trying to break it. But they were still in their comfort zone all this while. But I see Gen Z going all out, okay? I mean, I would say technically, because after 96, everything is Gen Z, we fall into Gen Z. But it's like, I have grown up with millennial cousins. So I always look up to Gen Zs having it so nice to, how they are so nice to each other. Like, you know, and that is something that has made them have that nuanced opinion, right? They were not shut down. They were not, they were allowed to express. And I am totally fine with 16, 17 year olds having that room to make a few mistakes. And then taking their time out, well, 17, 18, 19, they try to learn whatever they've learned. Because I would say that the same worked for me, where, yeah, I would say that in 11th and 12th, I was a little bit fixated on my views. But when I kind of went for degree and I did my majors in history, I realized that, hey, there was, I didn't know the whole picture. Now I know the whole picture. And I think I feel I'm well equipped to, you know, put my points forth. Or in the sense that talk about issues that have to be made relevant now, because earlier they were not even talked about because they were like, "Haan, ye to ho gaya, chalo niklo idhar se, move on from the past." But like that thing has to be brought again. That for me, that was the thing. My one of my teachers used to always say that you have to keep learning history because you're only never like the only way you're never gonna repeat the same mistakes. So. You don't, but we are the people who used to say, don't move on from the past, you know, learn from the past. That said, moving on is like a very, you know, out there concept for, you know, just, I would say it's a very gaslighting concept here. And, yeah. So I was like, yeah, let's learn from the past, keep those lessons with you and then go ahead however you want to go ahead. And I think Gen Z is just there with that idea altogether, you know, and, sorry, what was the second half of the question?
Yeah, so I was just asking you about the kind of solidarity you have experienced.
Oh, yeah. Correct. And I would say with the queer movement, it has been absolutely fabulous. I mean, I'm not even gonna, like, I have no doubt in the fact that the people who are leading it right now, whether they're trans men, trans women, gender non-binary folks, everyone, they are trying to give us so much space. And I can never thank them enough for that, you know, because yes, for the longest of time, cis men and women, in fact, as well. And even the elite viewpoint and the Savarna narrow viewpoint had just clouded that, hey, LGBTQ people should be happy. Now you have rights. And the thing is, just decriminalizing our existence is not rights, right? Like, that is not enough. Exactly. And I would have said that I got to learn all of that from so many queer, like, say, activists who put in their heart out to educate others, and all free of cost. And I would be, I was like so happy that in the way that they are also achieving their solidarity, they are also giving it out to so many people in their smallest of ways or even the heaviest of ways that they try to do it. And with that, I would say that Gen Z has been, say, like I said, they are all very accepting. Now, even a simplest action of putting pronouns in your bio, right? Even if I'm cisgender, I would do that because I was like, yeah, why would anyone assume my gender? Why would anyone assume my sexuality? Like, I would be clear. And now it's like, it's so seeped into my normal conversation that I would actually introduce myself as like, hey, I'm Namrata and my pronouns are she and her. And trust me, if that, even doing that much makes another person feel comfortable about, you know, showcasing their own preferred, or I wouldn't even say preferred, because my pronouns, so is the same for them. It's also pronouns for them.
Right.
Exactly. And if that is what's going to happen, I think that is the thing that Gen Z has given to me, you know, that, hey, don't assume anything about me until I tell you what it is. That, as simple as that. And that is the thing I want the government to take seriously, for example, you know, with the whole movement or with, you know, justice steps and due process. I don't want the elders here or the old people who are done with their innings to decide what's good for the Gen Z, you know. Like, you can give them a blueprint, but that blueprint should be editable. They have to be able to make changes like they want for that. You know, it's not supposed to be rigid. It's not supposed to be a rigid systemic structure. We have to give them clay, you know. I mean, I look, sound so like nurturing and motherly right now, but they need to get like a clay, and they need to like have it for themselves. And, you know, and the thing is, like I said, technically, because I'm 97 born, I feel I am Gen Z, you know. So very soon, I mean, even a few months ago, I have been all like, oh, millennials, you could have done a little bit better. You know, exactly. I keep telling myself that. And that's when I feel like, okay, you can also cut yourself some slack. It's okay. So, but the solidarity, like I said, has been amazing. They're so kind and they're so supportive. And they also give room for mistakes, you know. I mean, that's something I think we have not seen millennials do. They don't give much room for mistake.
I think this was exactly where my next question, like my second last question in the conversation, was also going towards. Like, as much as we talk about social media being an open space for you to start conversations and for you to actually voice your opinion, how often are you allowed to screw up? You know, like, is there something like, how do you know that, okay, like, I have screwed up enough and now maybe I should not? Or is there any room for you to make mistakes? Like, that's something that you just answered. But as much as visibility becomes interesting, becomes something that is a tool for you to go on, I feel like as you know, like you and I just made it into the Gen Z, like, by a very, very slim cut.
Yeah, exactly.
We realize the importance of making mistakes more than millennials or the Gen Z put together. We've come into that space where we have our elders who are so rigid about their beliefs. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, we have our like siblings and like friends who are younger and they're so open to everything. Does that sometimes become a fear? How does that sort of influence your process of research or how you look at the world at large?
Like, in a very, like, if you ask me in a very intrapersonal level, I would say that, yes, I am very scared to make mistakes, especially in a public platform. And the thing is, earlier, when I was, say, a bit younger, a lot of self-doubt was there in this, right? It always made me feel that, okay, if I'm wrong, I'm ruined for life. you know. So what happened was, I didn't want to be in that place, okay? But at the same time, I didn't want to be in a place where I'm like, hey, I have achieved so much self-esteem that I'm the perfect person on this planet. I can never be wrong. So these are the two extremes that we often see people be in, okay? And I would say here, something like grounding yourself is really, really important, right? So like the one thing would be like, if you're not an expert on something, do not speak about it unless you research on it, unless you ask an expert about it. Like I, with my content, for example, I never wanted to be someone who's like, main tumhe mera opinion bataunga and then you form an opinion on that as well. My contention has always been like, hey, this is what I researched. And I feel the experts are right here. What do you think? I try to tone myself like that. And that is one of the ways I try to ground myself when it comes to this research aspect, right? Where I don't want to be a person who doubts my, because I was a person like that. I used to doubt myself so much that it would often not let me make content because I doubted myself so much. Then what I did was, I never wanted to go into that space where I'm super overconfident about everything that I do. And the whole grounding exercises that we learn, or even simple having like a check, like I would be very honest and I would tell my friends, like whoever I trust, that, hey, anytime I'm doing something over the top, it sounds like preachy, or I sound like someone who is arrogant, straight up tell me, like, and right. You need to have those checks, especially if you're on a public platform that is gaining momentum.
You're right. And it's almost like you can actually read my mind, because my last question to you was just going to be this, right? So when we are talking about platform, we're talking about individual efforts as opposed to a collective or an organizational effort at the face of everything. What would still be... the value of if you had to ever evaluate the power of an individual in a collective movement as something like, you know, like, can you give us like a quick blueprint about how do we as listeners of this podcast, or how do we as individuals who exist on the internet today, how can we use our voice better? How can we do that individual effort as well and not just wait for the organizations to turn around?
Correct. So I would say, since on social media, most of it is, around the due process, right? Hey, email XYZ person, or try to ask your local governments and things like that. So a lot of time what happens is you very well get overwhelmed by this information that, hey, you have to send an email to XYZ person. And most of the time sending emails is like, it's not just one person you're sending an email to. It's like 2-3 people in that department you're sending an email to. So when you type in your own email as a young person, you are shit scared. Even I was in the beginning, where I was like, okay, my details are going to go to an authority who will know that, hey, I am opposing them for an XYZ project that they are doing. And that does intimidate young people. And the main thing is that you have to keep a know-how of your local body, like you said, right? You try to approach your local body for more options, but that's not happening. And like, that is a very good place to start, where you're going to be like, hey, I have to find out who my local body authority is, how do they work, or what are they open to these things and things like that. Like, I had a really good friend who recently went to our local body authority, and he was like from the garden department, and they just asked that, hey, we wanted to see if trees in our area can be deconcretized, because the concretization stops its water absorption process. And they were like, even the garden department was surprised that, you know, this particular individual came and asked such a question. So what then the individual did, like my friend, what he did was, you know what, I will collaborate with you on this, you know. And collaboration is the thing that Gen Zs do. I mean, that's the way you can take all the fire out of this. They were like, I will give you all the photos of, say, all the trees that are concretized, which can be deconcretized, or I'll send you all the photos. You decide which can be deconcretized and do that work. So I will do half the job for you, because most of the time they will tell you that, hey, you know what, we don't have the manpower right now. Hey, you know what? We don't have the budget for it right now. Because yes, the things that are important are not getting the budget, right? And that is where I think that individual contribution can come in, where you're just like, okay, I'll do the photos and you tell me what can be deconcretized. And that was a very good campaign, which worked pretty well. And it was done by this foundation called Muse Foundation. And they did it so well. Like, they formed a social media campaign and they were like, okay, anybody in their area, if there is a like a concretized tree, send us a photo of it with the location and we'll send it to the garden authority. And it will be like a collective group project that we're all doing together. And I mean, that inspired me also so much. And the same group is also has also done nail free trees, which was a earlier campaign which was going on pre-COVID. And I swear I miss pre-COVID era so much. Where, you know, what we used to do is we used to go to trees around our area, and anything that is nailed onto the tree, whether it's like a flyer, an advertisement, wires, and, you know, wood, anything that's nailed onto a tree, we used to remove it all out with, like, and the thing is, we used to do it every Sunday. And the thing is, after a few days, after a few weeks, when we used to go back to continue the rest of the trees, the people surrounding, like the people from the shops nearby or people who are coming and going, they're like, oh, we did the next few trees after we saw you doing it. And we were like damn happy that is the effect that it had, you know, that, oh, we just did it because we were free on Sunday and this seemed important to do. And it kind of pushed other people because they saw us doing it and they were like, okay, if they have their shops right in front of the tree, they can take care of that particular tree, right? That particular tree, they'll make sure that nobody comes and nails a tree. And I was like, this is ways you can start doing, or these are the ways that you can, you know, work on it. And yeah,
that is lucky. Now you just made me miss pre-COVID era. There is so much I missed, like having a cup of tea and having these conversations over it, right? Because, or just like meeting at an event in Bandra, which is something that we usually end up doing, and just chilling to some weird Black Eyed Peas song after. I hope those days come back soon. And thank you so much, Namrata. This has been... Okay, wait. I can't call you. Thank you so much. This has been... so cool. I've kept my, like, you know, I've literally written your name in front of me in a piece of paper. And then I was glad that you joined this link with Namrata on it so that I would remember to call you that. But no, you are Rabbit Bone forever. I know that you get weirded out.
I mean, I love that too, if you call me Rabbit Bone.
Thank you so much, and I cannot wait to see you.
Take care.
Are you constantly seeking happiness? Wondering how to make the most of every day? How not to let your inhibitions stop you from achieving your goals? It's now time to get your A-game on. It's time to unlock your true potential. Tune in to the Empowering Series with me, Zarina Poonawalla, to feel empowered in all genres of life. From behavioral skills to management skills, from health to relationships, from mental well-being to emotional well-being, and of course your finances. I've got you covered with these tips and tricks from me, Zarina, and true life stories from my amazing guests. You're bound to bring your purest to the table. Tune in to the Empowering Series with Zarina Poonawalla every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money, now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.